Hello, lovelies. It is laundry day, which means my headband is being washed, so I was sort of forced to actually do my hair. Apart from the headband, it is always in a top knot, unless I straighten it, which hardly ever happens. I'm also wearing my glasses today because the topic I want to talk about today, I will be reading stuff to you about. So, today I want to tell you guys about autistic catatonia. I would not be surprised if this is the first video out there on YouTube about it. It is not very commonly known about, especially by doctors. Most of the research started in the UK, so it's known about more there. And what we know is, what we know here in the US, I'm in the US, what we know here is drawn from the studies that were done in the UK. But there's very little research. Actually, there's more research out there now about it than there was back in August, which is when I had my first episode. I do have autistic catatonia, so I have a folder full of research, and I've looked yesterday, and even this many months later, there's more research and articles and stuff and information out there about it, which is exciting to me. Makes me happy that it's getting more known about, because it's very, very not known about. Catatonia is very grafted onto schizophrenia, and it was very hard for researchers to disconnect that and let it be seen as something that can be grafted onto autism. so it was a rough, I've mentioned in my past videos, I've gone through a lot of issues, medical issues and rough stuff, and a lot of that was when I first had my first catatonia episode. Because there was so little known about it, it was very difficult to figure out what was going on. You know, I did spend 2 weeks in a state mental hospital in the midst of that, because given the symptoms, you know, no one had any reason to believe that it wasn't that I wasn't experiencing psychosis, psychotic schizophrenia. But they did tests and ruled that out. I'm not schizophrenic or psychotic or delusional or anything like that. And the diagnosis was further confirmed by the administration of the one medication, if you can believe it, there's one medication that stops it, that reverses it. And basically, the way to diagnose it is, you know, if a person is experiencing the symptoms, which I will further get into, but if experiencing the symptoms, if the symptoms start to recede within 20-30 minutes after administering this medication, which does not affect a psychotic catatonia, that confirms the diagnosis. So I had that confirmed in the emergency room. I had multiple emergency room visits because it had gotten so severe that I had full-on catatonia, unresponsive. I had stopped eating. My blood sugar had fallen dangerously low, so multiple ambulances, because I was at school, I was in college at the time, and so my housemates and, you know, the school, they didn't know what was going on as much as I did, and I had just figured out that it was autistic catatonia by looking it up and trying to get the doctors to understand that, you know, in a world where it's, you know, people see mental, they want to diagnose mental illness before recognizing, you know, a neurological issue, which is what it is. It's very much a neurologically based issue. It's not a mental issue. But just to give you kind of a crash course, because it is complicated, autistic catatonia is similar to what you would understand. Catatonia is you know what? Let me just be able to give you some actual words. So I'm just reading from one of my sources, and I can link that for you if you'd like. Often, autism-associated catatonia looks quite different from classic catatonia, like in a psychosis, schizophrenia. For starters, it occurs across a spectrum from mild to severe. Severe looks a lot like classic catatonia, with individuals almost completely shutting down. In mild and moderate cases, parents often describe their teens slowing down or appearing depressed. Autistic-related catatonia, just like a schizophrenia psychosis, there's an age of onset, and autistic catatonia has an age of onset late teens, but also early 20s, which is I'm 26, and I had my first. I've had a few small episodes now that I know what it is, and maybe 1 or so years ago, but hardly before that. And this, what I consider my first episode, because it was so long, so prolonged, it wasn't treated, so it got really severe, is what I consider my first episode. So a little late of the onset. But in mild and moderate cases, parents often describe their teens slowing down or appearing depressed. Sometimes they become stuck when trying to initiate movement. For example, a teen might walk up to a doorway and then freeze at the threshold when it freeze when it is time to step over the threshold. So I just read that to you from the, because it's easier for me to explain. But really, I want to tell you about my experience, rather than being, just throwing a bunch of information at you. Basically, how it happened, how it started is I went nonverbal. It started with a slow loss of verbal ability. I started stuttering, which I don't have a stutter. I've never had that in my life. I started really struggling to get the words out. And again, this is in the timeline where it was being untreated, so it got worse and worse. So I went completely nonverbal. The first time I was nonverbal for about 4 or 5 months. Started learning sign language because at that time I didn't know what was going on. I had no idea, no reason to believe that this wasn't gonna be how I was like for forever. And then I went to college while nonverbal, and just the pressure of school and the stress and the things that I was dealing with, it just got worse and worse, and it just slowly progressed to the point where I started having movement issues. That's what came next. I walked like I was 100 years old, like an inch by inch by inch. I couldn't move very fast. And I did have the threshold issue. If I walked up to a threshold, I'd freeze and someone would have to prompt me to step over or show me. I also had just basic freeze moments during tasks or when trying to initiate a task. One of the common things is I'll be brushing my teeth and I'll freeze for a bit and then I'll keep going. And the worse it got, the more help I needed, the more prompting I needed to even get through a task. At one point, I had a fellow student who was a CNA had to help me shower because I would sit there and I would not know what to do. She had to prompt me through the curtain, okay, now grab your washcloth and wash your body, and like she had to step by step because I couldn't initiate tasks. It was a total executive dysfunction. Then the worse it got, I did have a few full-on unresponsive in my bed. I didn't leave my bed at this point for a couple weeks. I wasn't that long. It was about a week, and I'd stopped eating. That's the if you research, and in this actual same article, they talk about how autistic catatonia untreated is dangerous because individuals may stop eating, refuse food, and that becomes dangerous. And that is one of the things that put me in the emergency room and in the hospital once because I had stopped functioning, I'd stopped eating, and my blood sugar fell below something, I think it fell below 50. So I had spent the night in the hospital and they had to monitor my heart. I was having heart issues, and that's called autonomic dysfunction, and that's another complicated thing. Basically, with catatonia, or at least autistic catatonia, one of the dangers is that your autonomic system, so what regulates your heartbeat, regulates your breathing, your involuntary systems starts to have dysfunction. So your heart, my heart started not beating right. I'd having palpitations, and my blood pressure stopped being normal. It would spike, it would fall. So they had to have me in the hospital a couple days with a heart monitor to monitor my heart, because it was serious, it was dangerous. And and so that is a thing, that is a real thing. They this article, the doctor says that all autistic people should be assessed for catatonia, because they're realizing now more and more that it's a very real and dangerous issue, and if left untreated, it can get severe, and the longer it's left untreated, the harder it is to reverse. Once I started taking the right medication, I was able to move properly, I was able to function, but I still didn't get verbal back for a long time. The scary thing in my situation, the scary thing is that there is only one medication that treats it, and the other option is electroconvulsive therapy, basically rebooting the brain, shocking the brain. When it gets super severe, some autistic people have had to have ECT to kind of reboot their systems because the medication wasn't working. So where I'm at now, and I explain to people, you know, sometimes I have trouble talking, sometimes I don't. I'm on that medication, and I'm not on enough of it. The dose isn't high enough to last throughout the day and then throughout the night. So when I wake up in the morning is when I struggle. If I go too long in between doses, I'll start posturing. That's another catatonic thing. Catatonia symptom. Posturing is positions held against gravity. So my thing, I know I start posturing. I just like start holding my arm up. I don't even realize I'm doing it. So I know if I start posturing, I start struggle to walk very fast. And of course, speaking is the first thing to go for me. So it's very difficult in my situation, being not fully diagnosed autistic yet. I'm blessed to be able to receive that medication, you know, under another, you know, whatever diagnosis for anxiety, but that's not why I need it. But it's also hard to get the proper dosage and the proper, you know, how many times I take it a day, so that I'm not having these spaces where it wears off and I struggle. So mornings, I do struggle, until I take it. And, so that's just the general, I don't know what else to say about it, I guess. If you have questions, comment. Either about my experience or about just the science of it, because I know I did research in panic mode because I thought I was dying, you know, back then. But it is very real and is very serious, and my functionality as a person, my functionality as an autistic person, people, you know, I'm very high functioning, people say that, but if I stop taking this medication, I suddenly become completely dependent. Completely in need of care. I can't take care of myself. I can't function. I can't speak. Can't even walk. In the end stages of figuring this out and getting the right medication, I had to use a wheelchair because I couldn't move properly. It was just so slow, so exhausting. It exhausted me to, you know, walk from my bed to the bathroom. For me, it's a little scary right now because I tell people, like, yes, I'm high functioning, but my functionality, my life is literally dependent on this one medication. And if I suddenly stop receiving it, and not having health insurance is an issue. So if I suddenly can't get that medication, I stop being able to function the way that I can now. I stop being able to speak. And so I do know sign language, and that gives me peace because, you know, back then, when I was nonverbal, I had learned enough already where I was in the hospital and I could sign to the nurses and to the doctors and trying to explain to them what's going on. I had a really amazing story of one of the emergency room visits. I had a full-blown meltdown and they didn't know what was going on. screaming, hyperventilating, because they took my earplugs out. And at that point, I had them in all the time. I mentioned in my videos before, hearing is my most sensitive, and in that state of being totally non-functional, I had no self-regulation. Like, I could not handle. I had to have earplugs in all the time, just to function. And they had taken my earplugs out because I thought I couldn't hear them, and it was a full-blown meltdown, worst I've ever had. And the nurse that was in there just happened to know fingerspelling, so I was able to fingerspell to her, please put my earplugs back in, and I was able to calm down, and that confirmed to them. You know, they were asking me, has a doctor diagnosed you with autism? Because of course they're thinking psychosis, you know. But yeah, and so they gave the medication, and I was able to start moving again. And so even though I don't have an official diagnosis of that, I have records of doctors that I saw who, you know, in my mind it is confirmed, you know, that confirms that diagnosis. So I do suffer from autistic catatonia, and I absolutely have to take this medication to function. And I think a lot of people, they ask why, you know, why don't I have a job, or why am I, you know, you're so high functioning, why are you so non-functional like an adult should be, and that's it. My life is dependent on that medication, and I'm about to see my doctor in March, and there's a very real possibility that she might not continue prescribing it because she does not agree with the, she's not an autism specialist, so she, you know, she's prescribing it under the diagnosis of anxiety. Like I mentioned, I got off of one of the, I was on an antipsychotic for insomnia, which I got off of because it was not good. And I'm fairly, like, I'm certain she will not want to prescribe that medication with, when I've gotten off of this, gotten off of this other, not being a psychiatrist, not being an autism specialist. So that'll be an interesting time in my life if I do lose that medication. But it may end up being a good thing, because if I go back into catatonia, you know, I might be able to go to a doctor and have that diagnosis officially confirmed by re-administering that medication. But yeah, so it's rare. It is a rare condition, and it's not known about, and it's very difficult in my situation. A lot of doctors, even psychiatrists, are like, I've had to take my folder of research and say, this, you know, it's autistic catatonia, this is what it is, please believe me, you know. But it was a rough time, but I'm, like, happy to be, you know, that I have what I need now. I have the medication I need to function and to speak, and I'm, you know, I'm still learning sign language. I'm not fully fluent, just for the situation, if I ever, you know, I do still have nonverbal days and nonverbal situations, because it is very, it can be triggered by high anxiety. And I could say so much about this, guys. I might do a part two, because I'm fascinated by it, but it's just, it's so tied into autism and meltdowns, the fight or flight response, you know. The researchers with autistic catatonia, they make the argument that it's, we have fight or flight, but that actually it's not just fight or flight, it's fight or freeze, and that the catatonia response is the freeze response. So it can be triggered by extreme anxiety. I've had situations where I've exhausted myself, so I'm even on this medication, but I'm exhausted, and I still go nonverbal. That's always the first thing, because I'm just too exhausted. But that was my really, really fast explanation of that, and this video is starting to get too long. YouTube might reject it. But that's autistic catatonia, crash course for you. If you have questions, please ask them, and I'll address them in later videos. But this video can't get any longer. And that's all for today. I'll post another video later about more fun stuff. But for now, okay, bye.